لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله حبيبنا وحبيب رب العالمين. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. UCAM Youth welcomes you all today to this program of A Rightful Recital. Alhamdulillah, with the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are honored to have amongst us Qari Fatih Sefragic, all the way from the United States of America. He's been traveling up and down the country with the UCAM Youth, and we are very grateful to him for that. It's also a special blessing for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he chose us to be amongst the Muslims. Out of all the millions of people in this country, he chose us to be Muslims, and he chose us to be here today in this blessed program. So indeed, we have to be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he chose us to be amongst those people. I'll just make you aware, for those who have not been in this building before, about the fire exits. There's no fire alarm planned today, but if there is one, then that's a real one. The fire exits one, where people have come in from, at the back there, and one just on my left there. I'd also request that you switch your mobile phones off to silent during the program, and that this afternoon's program will consist of a short recitation of the Quran, followed by a reminder of hadith, inshallah, and then we will discuss a little bit about what we do in this center, followed by Qari Fatih's main presentation, a recital, inshallah. And then we'll just finish off with a reminder of the ongoing crisis in Syria and what we can do to help, followed by dua, inshallah. So to start then, inshallah, I'd just like to welcome Ubayd Farid to recite a few verses of the Quran.
A'udhu billahi minash shaytani ar-rajim. Bismillahi ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Wat-teeni waz-zaytun. وطور سينين وهذا البلد الأمين لقد خلقنا الإنسان في أحسن تقويم ثم رددناه أسفل سافلين إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات فلهم أجر غير ممنون فما يكذبك بعد بالدين أليس الله بأحكم الحاكمين. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. By the fig and the olive and the mountain of Sinai and this secure city, we have indeed created humankind in the fairest form. Then we brought them down to the lowest of the low, except for those who believe and do righteous deeds, for theirs shall be an unfailing recompense. Who then can give you the lie as to the last judgment? Is not Allah the most just of judges? Jazakallah khair.
JazakAllah khair, Ubayd, for that recitation of the Quran. I'd now like to welcome Brother Muhammad Qasim to give us a short reminder of hadith, inshallah.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Nahmaduhu wa salli ala rasulihil kareem. Amma ba'd. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. My dear respected elders, brothers and sisters in Islam, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. The average lifespan of a human being consists of four stages. From birth till teenage, roughly around 12 years. Then from teenage years up until the time he gets married, around 7 to 8 years. And then from the time he gets married till the age of 40. And then from 40 when he goes and dies. And that time frame is unknown, as the time of death is uncertain to us. Death is certain. Kullu nafsin za'iqatul maut. Every soul shall taste death. But the most important part, the most important stage in the lifespan of a human being is the time from him when he gets married up until the age of 40, as that is a time known as the youth. So much significance has been given to this part of life. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam says that a person who spends his life during the youth, especially in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then on the day of resurrection, on the day of resurrection, when there shall be no other shade apart from the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's throne. And there will be seven types of people beneath it. And one of the categories is a person of youth. A youth who spent his life in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what I would like, the hadith which I would like to share with you today, is a very famous hadith which we all know. And as a reminder, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that take benefit of five before five. Take benefit of five before five. Your youth before your old age. So even then again, the significance, importance about our youth is again stressed here. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that take benefit of it before your old age. Because it is the youth at the time when we have the energy, when we are very enthusiastic to do anything and we feel to have the power of all worlds on our hands. None is there to stop us. And during that phase, we surrender ourselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We put our desires to aside and we choose the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then of course there is great reward to be given for that. Health before your sickness. We often take this as granted, just as like our youth. But when we become sick, we can't do many things. But when we are healthy, we can choose to do many things, but we decide not to before we become sick. So the Prophet ﷺ said that take benefit of your health before your sickness. And also again, about your wealth. About your wealth before you become before your poverty. And then free time before your preoccupation. Now free time, many of us, especially the youth, we have a lot of free time on our hands. But we decide not to utilize it effectively. Before we actually become preoccupied, for example, when a person becomes married, then thereafter, if he feels he doesn't have that much time on his hands. And we often, as a youth, procrastinate. We leave things to aside. We tend to say, not today, we'll do tomorrow. And that, the Prophet ﷺ said that, take benefit of your free time before your preoccupation. And lastly, he said that take benefit of your life before your death. And like I said, every one of us will go through that phase of death. And for each and every one of us, that time is different. It is not certain for us that many of the youth have this preconceived idea that we live our youth freely as we want to. And when we become old, and then at that time, we shall go onto the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But little do we know that it may be in our youth that we depart from this world. And just as a food for thought before I do leave, inshallah, I would like to leave with you another hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he said that a man shall be asked about five things on the day of resurrection. On the day of resurrection, a man shall be asked in regards to five matters. The first, concerning his life, as to how he spent his life. And then not just about his life, but more specifically asked about how did you spend your youth. And how we grew old. Concerning his wealth. So a man shall be also asked about our wealth, how we acquired our wealth and how he spent it. Did we spend it in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Now another thing is that when we think of charity, we say we monetary value, we have to give something in return. But another form of charity is when we have our resources, for example, in our youth, we have a lot of energy. We utilize that energy in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another form of charity. And then He also says the last part of this is that what we do with the knowledge we have, do we utilize that knowledge? It is no good just to know something without amal, without action. My dear respected brothers, so inshallah what we should try, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq, the ability to spend whatever time frame we are in, our youth, a majority of us sitting here are in that time frame, because we, I'm sure we're not older than 40, apart from a few, But inshallah, even then, we should spend it in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and mainly do dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He accepts what we do, inshallah. Wa akhra du'ana, alhamdulillah.
JazakAllah khair, Brother Qasim, for that important reminder about time and to take advantage of the time that we have in our youth to secure our akhirah. JazakAllah khair. And related to this, I'd just like to mention that in this centre we have a youth circle, a UKIM youth circle. It's every Saturday at 6 o'clock and we have lots of activities such as a gym that we can use, boxing facilities in there, table tennis, pool, snooker, as well as discussion about Islam. We have small discussions of issues relevant to the youth, as well as small reminders sometimes that we play clips from prominent speakers, and we've got all the facilities here. So please do take advantage of the UKIM Youth Circle. Do come every Saturday at 6 o'clock, and it's for all age groups, so please take part in that. And I'd like to invite Brother Kashif Feroz to talk a bit more about the EIIS, which is the Islamic Institute here, and what we do here.
Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, wa salatu wa salamu ala Rasulihi al-Kareem, amma ba'd, fa'audhu billahi min shaytan ar-rajim, bismillahir rahmanir rahim, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My dear respected and honored guest, Qari Fateh, and brothers and sisters. I've been asked just to say a few quick words about the current programs and activities that we are running here at the center. You just heard from Brother Qasim about utilizing, the importance of utilizing your time more effectively. And one of the best ways and the most important ways that we can do that is to seek knowledge, is to seek the ilm of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is to seek the knowledge of the deen. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in many places the honor of those people who seek knowledge. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, the first word that was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was Iqra, read. So our base starts from knowledge. And in the current climate that we're in the current conditions, the environment that we're in, it becomes even more essential that we understand our deen, that we understand the knowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. That is to become more resilient. Today you've got so many temptations, especially our young people, they're faced with so much challenges, so much temptation, that without knowledge, without the proper understanding of Islam, it's going to be very, very difficult, very, very difficult to safeguard your deen, very difficult to safeguard your identity. So the Prophet ﷺ, that's why he made it fard, compulsory on every individual, Muslim, male and female, to learn knowledge. And the Prophet ﷺ said in another hadith, مَنْ خَرَجَ فِي طَلَبِ الْعِلْمِ فَهُوَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ حَتَّى يَرْجِعِ, that whoever goes out to seek knowledge, he is struggling in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until he returns home. So this is a blessed journey that every one of us needs to undertake. And alhamdulillah, by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we've started in this institute, in this place, in this center, we've started an institution called the European Institute of Islamic Sciences. And we are running programs and courses during the weekdays, in the evening times, where you can learn your deen, learn Quran, Tajweed, Arabic, and then on the weekend we have an Islamic studies course, which is a part-time Islamic studies course, which covers Quran, Hadith, Fiqh, Seerah, and Arabic. And that starts at 10 o'clock in the morning and finishes at 5:30 p.m. every Saturdays, inshallah. And it'll be a 2-year course. So hopefully, inshallah, if you graduate from those 2 years, you'll be well on your path to becoming a seeker of knowledge and an alim, inshallah. Apart from that, inshallah, at the center, we are also running a weekday evening school for children between the ages of 5 and 13 years old. There is also a HIFS class that is running at the center, and other youth programs that we have just started, as Brother Waqas has mentioned. I don't want to take up too much of your time, so I'm going to, inshallah, we have our guest here. So without further ado, I will, inshallah, pass on. Just there's a short advert that we want to play. Inshallah, this is airing on Islam Channel at the moment, which is a little bit of an introduction to the courses that we're running. Jazakallah khair.
Learn and study Islam at the European Institute of Islamic Sciences. New flexible weekend Islamic courses covering Tajweed, Quran, Tafsir, Arabic, Fiqh, Aqidah, Hadith and Sirah. Courses also available during weekends and evenings for both male and females. Our courses are taught by qualified and dynamic teachers in a modern and comfortable environment. Enroll now at www.eiis.org.uk.
Jazakallah khair, Brother Kashif, for that. It's now time for our main event. Qari Fateh Sefragic is a Bosnian by nationality. He was born in Germany and moved to the United States at the age of 4. He completed his HIFS at the Islamic Society of Baltimore under Sheikh Qari Zahid and Qari Abid, and then moved to Dallas to study classical Arabic at Bayna's Dream program. He currently lives in Houston, Texas, and is a student as well as a teacher of the Quran. Qari Fateh is also a YouTube sensation, having over 1 million views for his Tarawih recording. So without any further ado, I would like to welcome Qari Fateh to perform a rite for the title.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
These are always annoying to put on, especially this one. I can't even pinch it.
How's everyone doing? أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم حم تنزيل الكتاب من الله العزيز العليم غافر الذنب وقابل التوب شديد العقاب ذي الطول لا إله إلا هو إليه المصير ما يجادل في آيات الله إلا الذين كفروا فلا يغرك تقلبهم في البلاد كذبت قبلهم قوم نوح والأحزاب من بعدهم وهمت كل أمة برسولهم ليأخذوه وجادلوا بالباطل ليدحضوا به الحق فأخذتهم فكيف كان عقاب وكذلك حقت كلمة ربك على الذين كفروا أنهم أصحاب النار النار الذين يحملون العرش ومن حوله يسبحون بحمد ربهم ويؤمنون به ويستغفرون للذين آمنوا ربنا وسعت كل شيء رحمة وعلما فاغفر للذين تابوا واتبعوا سبيلك وقهم عذاب الجحيم ربنا وأدخلهم جنات عدن التي وعدتهم ومن صلح من آبائهم وأزواجهم وذرياتهم إنك أنت العزيز الحكيم وقهم السيئات ومن تق السيئات يومئذ فقد رحمته وذلك هو الفوز العظيم إن الذين كفروا ينادون لمقت الله أكبر من مقتكم أنفسكم أكبر من مقتكم أنفسكم إذ تدعون إلى الإيمان فتكفرون قالوا ربنا أمتنا اثنتين وأحييتنا اثنتين فاعترفنا بذنوبنا فهل إلى خروج من سبيل ذلكم بأنه إذا دعي الله وحده كفرتم وإن يشرك به تؤمنوا فالحكم لله العلي الكبير هو الذي يريكم آياته وينزل لكم من السماء رزقا وما يتذكر إلا من فادعوا الله مخلصين له الدين ولو كره الكافرون رفيع الدرجات ذو العرش يلقي الروح من أمره على من يشاء من عباده لينذر يوم يوم هم بارزون لا يخفى على الله منهم شيء لمن الملك اليوم لله الواحد القهار اليوم تجزى كل نفس بما كسبت لا ظلم اليوم إن الله سريع الحساب وأنذرهم يوم الآزفة إذ القلوب لدى الحناجر كاظمين ما للظالمين من حميم ولا شفيع يطاع يعلم خائنة الأعين وما تخفي الصدور والله يقضي بالحق والذين يدعون من دونه لا يقضون بشيء إن الله هو السميع البصير أولم يسيروا في الأرض فينظروا كيف كان عاقبة الذين كانوا من قبلهم كانوا هم أشد منهم قوة وآثارا في الأرض فأخذهم الله بذنوبهم وما كان لهم من الله من واق ذلك بأنهم كانت تأتيهم رسلهم بالبينات فكفروا فأخذهم الله إنه قوي شديد العقاب ولقد أرسلنا موسى بآياتنا وسلطان مبين إلى فرعون وهامان وقارون فقالوا ساحر كذاب فلما جاءهم بالحق من عندنا قالوا اقتلوا أبناء الذين آمنوا معه واستحيوا نساءهم وما كيد الكافرين إلا في ضلال وقال فرعون ذروني أقتل موسى وليدع ربه أخاف أن يبدل دينكم أو أن يظهر في الأرض الفساد وقال موسى إني عذت بربي وربكم من كل متكبر لا يؤمن بيوم الحساب بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم كافها يا عينصاد ذكر رحمة ربك عبده زكريا نادى ربه نداء خفيا قال رب إني وهن العظم مني واشتعل الرأس شيبا ولم أكن بدعائك رب شقيا وإني خفت الموالي من ورائي وكانت امرأتي عاقرا فهب لي من لدنك وليا يرثني ويرث من آل يعقوب واجعله رب رضيا يا زكريا إنا نبشرك بغلام اسمه يحيى لم نجعل له من قبل سميا قال رب أنى يكون لي غلام وكانت امرأتي عاقرا وقد بلغت من الكبر عتيا قال كذلك قال ربك هو علي هين وقد خلقتك من قبل ولم تك شيئا قال رب اجعل لي آية قال آيتك ألا تكلم الناس ثلاث ليال سويا فخرج على قومه من المحراب فأوحى إليهم أن سبحوا بكرة وعشيا يا يحيى خذ الكتاب بقوة وآتيناه الحكم صبيا وحنانا من لدنا وزكاة وكان تقيا وبرا بوالديه ولم يكن جبارا عصيا وسلام عليه يوم ولد ويوم يموت ويوم يبعث حيا واذكر في الكتاب مريم إذ انتبذت من أهلها مكانا شرقيا فاتخذت من دونهم حجابا فأرسلنا إليها روحنا فتمثل لها بشرا سويا قالت إني أعوذ بالرحمن منك إن كنت تقيا قال إنما أنا رسول ربك لأهب لك غلاما زكيا قالت أنى يكون لي غلام ولم يمسسني بشر ولم أك بغيا قال كذلك قال ربك هو علي هين ولنجعله آية للناس ورحمة وكان أمرا مقضيا فحملته فانتبذت به مكانا قصيا فأجاءها قالت يا ليتني مت قبل هذا وكنت نسيا منسيا فناداها من تحتها ألا تحزني قد جعل ربك تحتك سريا وهزي إليك بجذع النخلة تساقط عليك رطبا جنيا فكلي واشربي وقري عينا فإما ترين من البشر أحدا فقولي إني نذرت للرحمن صوما فلن أكلم اليوم إنسيا صدق الله العظيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني. Inshallah, today I'm going to be talking about something that you hear lots and lots about. All of us know that we sin, we make mistakes, and we're always told that we have to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Nisa, Ayahs number 17 and 18. بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إنما التوبة على الله للذين يعملون السوء بجهالة ثم يتوبون من قريب فأولئك يتوب الله عليهم وكان الله عليما حكيما وليست التوبة للذين يعملون السيئات حتى إذا حضر أحدهم الموت قال إني تبت الآن ولا الذين يموتون وهم كفار أولئك أعتدنا لهم عذابا أليما. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and remember that Allah's acceptance of repentance is only for those who commit evil out of ignorance and then soon repent. It is towards such persons that Allah turns graciously. Allah is all-knowing, all-wise. But of no avail is the repentance of those who do evil until death approaches any of them. And then he says, now I repent. Nor is the repentance of those who die in a state of unbelief of any avail for them. For them we have kept in readiness a painful chastisement. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran in many places that as long as we repent to Him, that He will forgive us. But before I even get into these ayat, I want to mention one really important thing. No human being is above forgiveness. No human being is above the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to ask Allah, I want you guys to hear this. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who is that? The Prophet. How many times did he ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness every single day? It is said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness around 70 times a day. 70. That's the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the most perfect human being. Right? So, we as Muslims living today, who are obviously probably doing a lot worse than the Prophet ﷺ will ever do in his lifetime, in one day maybe, how many times are we asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to actually forgive us? And even though the Prophet ﷺ was a perfect human being, he was asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was constantly reassuring him in the Quran, like, don't worry man, you're okay. Why are you stressing? You're fine. Why are you asking me for forgiveness? You're okay. You're going to Jannah. You're the Prophet. But despite all of that, all those reassurances that he was getting from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala,
the Prophet would still ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive him every single day. And there's something that most of us don't realize. People think that forgiveness or asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive you is only for the bad things that you do. Right? Like, I sinned today, or I did something bad, so I'm going to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive me. But something really, really, really crucial and important that people don't realize is that even in the good deeds that we do, in the good actions that we do, I'll give you one example, our salah, our prayer. Right? When we pray, or when we make wudu, maybe we're praying, maybe we're making wudu, but maybe we're not doing it as perfectly as we're supposed to. Maybe we're not doing it how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to. Maybe there's flaws in our prayer. Right? On the outside, all of us look the same when we're praying. Right? We're all standing next to each other and we all look the same. But the angels, when they're writing down our deeds, they're not just writing down what they see on the outside. Because the quality of your salah on the inside matters as well. So the angels are writing that as well. So we're taught not to only ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness for the bad things that we do, but to also ask Him to forgive us for all the shortcomings, all of our shortcomings and the good things that we do as well. Right? So, I'm praying for you, Ya Rabb. This is for you. And maybe it's not perfect. I'm trying to do it as best as I can, and there's probably some flaws in what I'm doing. So forgive me for that as well. And that being said, now I want you guys to think about this. You already thought, man, I probably sin, make so many mistakes. I'm such a horrible person. I have so much to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive me for. But now thinking about, on top of all that, all the good that you do as well, all the mistakes and flaws that you might have in that as well, and it piles up to even more. And all of this is just to say that we are in the need of mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because we are always going to be sinning, or we're always going to be making mistakes. It's part of us as human beings, it's in our nature. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, in Surah Nisa, this is like my favorite two verses. Like if these are verses to live by, honestly. Especially for the youth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts off by saying, بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم والله يريد أن يتوب عليكم. But the first two words, وَاللَّهُ يُرِيد. What does that mean? It means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants. That's all I'll say for now. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants. Now I want you guys to just internalize this a bit. This is not your mom that wants something from you. This isn't your buddy, right? This isn't, you know, your boss or no one. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that created you and gave you everything. He wants something from you. Right? So when he says in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants, you gotta pay attention. It's really important. So what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? He wants something from us. Wallahu yuridu ay yatuba alaykum. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He wants our repentance. He wants us to ask for forgiveness. Of all the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have asked us for, of all the things, what did He say? He wants what? Us to ask Him for forgiveness. وَاللَّهُ يُرِيدُ أَن يَتُوبَ عَلَيْكُمْ وَيُرِيدُ الَّذِينَ يَتَّبِعُونَ الشَّهَوَاتِ أَن تَمِيلُوا مَيْلًا عَظِيمًا. And then, there's going to be people around you that want something as well. There's going to be people that follow their desires and don't really care and do whatever they want. And they're going to want you to join them and follow your desires as well. Give in to all of your desires. So you have on one hand, you have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that wants something, and then you have these people that could care less about what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants, and they just follow all of their desires and they want you to do something as well. So which one will you choose? وَاللَّهُ يُرِيدُ أَن يَتُوبَ عَلَيْكُمْ وَيُرِيدُ الَّذِينَ يَتَّبِعُونَ الشَّهَوَاتِ أَن تَمِيلُوا مَيْلًا عَظِيمًا. All that in one ayah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on to say, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ أَن يُخَفِّفَ عَنْكُمْ وَخُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ ضَعِيفًا. يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ أَن يُخَفِّفَ عَنْكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants something else from us. What does He want this time? First, He wanted us to ask Him for forgiveness. In the second ayah, He's saying, you know what? I want to make it easy for you. I want to lighten your burdens for you. يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ أَن يُخَفِّفَ عَنْكُمْ. I want to make it easier for you. Why? وَخُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ ضَعِيفًا. Because the human being was created weak. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us. He knows we're going to sin. He knows we're going to make mistakes. He knows all of us are going to make mistakes. He knows none of us are perfect. There's no such thing as a perfect human being, myself included. Oftentimes, you know, people, you know, see a sheikh or an imam or someone that's a hafiz, but they don't realize that as human beings, we're all human beings and we make the same mistakes. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala acknowledges this. And He says, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ يُخَفِّفَ عَنْكُمْ وَخُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ ضَعِيفًا. And just about the wording that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses, by the way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, see what you guys are looking at. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the word insan for human being. Now, insan is human being in Arabic, but the word insan comes from the same three root letters in Arabic that you would use for the word I forgot. Like if you wanted to say I forgot in Arabic, you would say nasitu. So those root letters have that meaning of forgetfulness. So just by the nature of the word human being, insan, it has that meaning of forgetfulness. This is a forgetful human being. You're going to make mistakes. We're all going to forget and we're going to slip up. But what's important is what you do afterwards when you realize that's a mistake. Do you continue making those mistakes or do you do something about it? Ali radiallahu anhu, he was passing by a guy making istighfar, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. And this guy was just like ratting it out. He was reciting it. Something very common amongst us. Right? So this guy is saying, astaghfirullah, 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 astaghfirullah. He's probably thinking the game or something, astaghfirullah. He's not even paying attention. And Ali radiallahu anhu, he sees that, he looks at the guy and he says, your istighfar needs istighfar. He's like, your istighfar that you're making needs some istighfar. Because what is that? Every time you ask for forgiveness, you should be thinking about the sins that you're making. You should be concentrating. It should be more important to you than just reciting it or chanting it just to get it done with. And when a person starts thinking about all the sins that they've made, two things start happening. The first thing is you become overwhelmed. You feel like you're ruined, like there's no hope for you, right? You're gonna go to hell. I'm not worthy of Jannah. I've made so many mistakes, right? And that's not a good thing necessarily. That is not a good thing necessarily. Now another thing which happens, which is kind of a good thing, is you stop worrying so much about other people. When you start realizing how many mistakes you're making in your life, and how much you have to work on, when you truly internalize that and realize that, you completely stop worrying about other people. Because now you're worried about yourself. And a sign of someone that thinks that they're perfect and that, you know, they have nothing to work on or whatever and that they're completely okay is when they're going around pointing out the mistakes and flaws in everyone else's lives. You have to work on this. You have to work on this. Why aren't you doing this? Why aren't you doing this? You should be doing this. It's like, akhi, are you so satisfied with your life and all of your actions that you have so much time to be worrying about everyone else except for yourself? Because in the day of judgment, these people are not going to come and worry about you. It's going to be every man for themselves. And when you start getting so concerned with what you yourself are doing, there might get a point where you feel like there's no hope. You might feel like, man, I've made so many mistakes, I've done so much bad in my life, there's no hope for me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala won't forgive me. Right? There's no way I'm going to get into Jannah. But you have to realize, hope is a very, very, very strong thing. And it's really important for human beings. Because when human beings lose all hope, right? It's one of the most dangerous psychological states a human being can get in, when they lose all hope. Because when they lose all hope, they overdose on drugs, right? They commit suicides, commit all kinds of crimes. They're willing to do all kinds of things because they've reached the absolute bottom when you lose that hope. So hope is really, really important. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't leave us hopeless. The Prophet told us that all children of Adam make mistakes and sin. And then he added on top of that, but the best ones amongst those are the ones that ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive them. In any society, this is important, in any society, you guys know how it is. If you commit a crime, if you have a criminal record, it's going to follow you for the majority of your life. It's like a dark cloud above you. Like anywhere you go, you apply for a job, you try going somewhere, right? It's always there. You did this 10 years ago. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with His mercy, with all the mistakes and all the things that we do, when it goes on our record, when we ask Him to forgive us, when we're sincere, He completely removes everything. And we have a fresh start. And it doesn't haunt us for the rest of our lives and impact us. As long as we're sincere. And Allah doesn't just stop there, subhanAllah. He doesn't just forgive you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Furqan, فَأُولَٰئِكَ يُبَدِّلُ اللَّهُ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ حَسَنَاتٍ. Those people that truly, truly, truly repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm not talking about the guy that goes clubbing on Friday and then wakes up in the morning hungover and then feels bad and asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive him. And then comes Saturday night and then he's bored and he goes out again. And then Sunday morning he's hungover and he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive him. That's just playing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm talking about someone that truly repents to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah tells us, I will take their mountains of sins. Not one or two sins. If you truly repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will take the mountains of sins that you have. And He won't just get rid of them for you, which would be amazing in itself to show His mercy. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you truly repent, I will take these mountains of sins that you have made. Not only will I remove them from your record, I will turn all of them into good deeds. Subhanallah. He will turn all of your bad deeds into good deeds. And we have a lot of bad deeds, which means that's a lot of good deeds. You don't have to be a mathematician to understand this. Right? But that's the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you truly repent and ask Him for forgiveness, He's always there for you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran as well, إِلَّا مَا رَحِمَ رَبُّكَ وَلِذَٰلِكَ خَلَقَهُمْ مَا يَفْعَلَ اللَّهُ بِعَذَابِكُمْ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, what is He going to do punishing us? Do you think Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to punish us? Allah asks us that question in the Quran. What's He going to do punishing you? He didn't create you to punish you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's not like The Sims. If you guys ever played The Sims, this is just the only example that comes off the top of my mind. You know, you can like make these little guys in their houses and like you can destroy their walls or something and like they're stuck and they can't go anywhere. And they, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't do that to us. He didn't create us to put us on this earth just to mess with us and tease us and make things hard for us and then just punish us at the end. People have that misconception of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala where they think He's just waiting for me to slip up. He's just waiting for me to make a mistake so that He can punish me. Right? And that also comes because you have so many people around you that are always, they can't wait for you to mess up either. Human beings. Right? Those guys that think that they have nothing to worry about themselves, they just go around, they wait for someone else to make a mistake. They judge other people. The moment you slip up, brother, do you know if you do this, what's going to happen to you? Like, it's okay. Why are you telling me this? Worry about yourself, I'll worry about myself. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't create me to punish me. He created us to show us mercy. So we, as Muslims, we have to live for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and live for His mercy. Now, I'm going to conclude with this. And the reason why I wanted to mention this, because I do see a lot of youth here. I myself am a youth as well. The most important thing is, first of all, I don't know that many youth. It's like very rare for me to find someone that's really young, that's completely flawless, like a perfect, mashallah, like, you know, you have nothing to say before them. Like, everyone has something. Everyone has something. Everyone is struggling with something. Everyone has something in their lives that they have to overcome, whether you're young or old. But mainly for these young people, it's really difficult. It's really difficult. There is so much around us today, in today's society, which makes it so hard to be a Muslim. It's not cool to be a Muslim. No one sees you walking in your thobe down Curry Street and is like, yo, that guy, you know? They start honking at you because you're wearing a thobe. No, if they're honking at you, they're making fun of you, right? It's not cool to be a Muslim. It's not cool to be religious. Right? So if you want to fit in today's society, if you want to be accepted, I mean, Muslim's not the way to go. That's what we're told. That's how it's, you know, that's how we're treated. And on top of that, there's just so many other things. There's just so many other things that make it even that much harder. So when you see a youth, if someone is here today for a lecture, that's enough. The fact that someone took out their time on a weekend to be here and just listen to this for like, what, an hour? I mean, dude, Liverpool and Manchester City are playing right now. If you're not watching it on your phone secretly, I was watching it on my iPad, by the way. I wasn't looking at notes. I'm just kidding. But if you're here, if you sacrifice that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to reward you. That's something. That's a lot more than you can say for a lot of other people right now. How many people are probably right now still hungover in bed from last night? Right? So don't, and this is my advice to the older people. Don't be too hard on the young, like the young teenagers, the young youth around you. If you see them making mistakes, advise them in a nice way. Try to be there for them. Don't look for that first opportunity where you can point out, hey, why are you doing this? Right? The uncle, are they bhai, what are you doing? This is haram. Right? That's my impression of an uncle, by the way. That's, it happens. You guys think that there's only Pakistani and Indian people here in UK. No, no, no. We got a lot in America too. I grew up with them. It's no different. I know how it is. You got to be understanding. I cannot stress that enough. You have to be understanding of people's situations. It is really, really, really hard to be a Muslim today. Don't make it harder. That's my last advice. Don't make it harder. Try to make it easier. Try to be there for someone. And remember that no one, doesn't matter how much you've sinned, If you truly repent, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He'll forgive you. And I'm going to end with this. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, to give us an example of how happy Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gets when you ask Him for forgiveness. To give us an example of how happy Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gets with us when we ask Him for forgiveness. He says, it's like that man that's in the desert. He's going on a journey and he's on his camel. And back then, by the way, they didn't have cars with AC and, you know, like all that space, and you can put your stuff in the trunk and everything is like, you know, like 5 minutes away, no worries, no. Your camel is your car, and you put all your stuff on it, your food, your clothes, your provisions. And if that camel runs off or wanders away in the middle of the desert on your journey, you could die. Because there's no gas stations for miles. It's a desert. It's just sun and heat. There's no water. There's no food. So if your camel runs away, you're going to be stressed. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is telling us, it's like that guy that's on that journey and he has all of his belongings and provisions and everything with him on that camel. And that camel runs away. He goes like take a nap and the camel runs away. And he wakes up and that camel is gone. Now this guy starts panicking. He thinks he's gonna, you know, die. That's it. Like, my camel is gone. I have no food, no water. I'm in the middle of the desert, in the middle of nowhere. Like, he starts losing hope. He starts hallucinating, starts going crazy, right? And then he lays down and he starts accepting the fact that he's gonna die. Like, he's like, oh, that's it. I'm gonna die. And he's sitting there and he's like, there's no hope for me. And then out of nowhere, he sees his camel walking by him. Just out of nowhere. He's sitting there thinking about how he's gonna die, and the camel just walks by. This guy gets so happy that he jumps up. He jumps up. And you know when people are overly excited, or when they're, you know, enthusiastic about something, they can't say something properly. So he goes, oh Allah, you are my servant and I am your master. Na'udhubillah. He's trying to say, I am your servant and you're my master. He's trying to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but he's so happy and overwhelmed with emotion when he sees his camel. He says the opposite. So the Prophet ﷺ is trying to give us that image in our minds. That's how happy that guy was. He was so overwhelmed with emotion when he found his camel again. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is even more happy when we ask Him for forgiveness. That's something to remember. So don't ever, ever think that you've made too many mistakes in your life, that it's too late for you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you. But also, don't wait until it's too late. Don't wait until, you know, as the brother mentioned earlier, where you think you can, you know, do whatever you want until you're like 50 or 60, if you live that long. And then you're going to be like, all right, I'm going to retire my life of bad deeds now, put the cape up, right? And I'm going to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive me. And it's going to work beautifully and you're going to enter Jannah. And that's how the world works. It doesn't work that way. Don't play with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you're going to ask Him for forgiveness, be sincere about it, and truly, truly try to change yourself. وأقول قولي هذا استغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين والحمد لله رب العالمين.
جزاك الله خير قاري فاتح for that beautiful recitation and that wonderful reminder. Indeed, it was an honor and a privilege to be able to listen to that. جزاك الله خير for that. Before we finish for dua, I'd just like to thank Qari Fateh for coming to our masjid all the way from the United States and to touring with UKIM. I'd also like to thank UKIM Youth for organizing this tour. JazakAllah khair to all of you for that. And finally, I'd like to thank all of you who took time out of your Sunday afternoon to come here and to listen to the Quran here. So may Allah reward you for that. Once again, a reminder about weekly circles here. We have circles every Saturday at 6 p.m. Please do get involved and you'll have countless benefits inshallah. And finally, I'd just like to also remind you that we've got a bookstall near the entrance and the donations from that go towards this centre and running this centre. So please do purchase some books inshallah. JazakAllah khair. I'd like to invite Hafiz Salim inshallah to finish off with a dua.
Assalamu alaikum. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, wa salatu wa salamu ala Rasulil Ameen, amma ba'd. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Mawlana Muhammad wa ala ala Sayyidina Mawlana Muhammad wa barik wa sallam. Rabbana zalamna anfusana wa illam taghfir lana wa tarhamna lanakunanna. الخاسرين ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار اللهم آنس وحشتنا في قبورنا اللهم ارحمنا بالقرآن العظيم واجعله لنا إماما ونورا وهدى ورحمة اللهم ذكرنا منه ما نسينا وعلمنا منه ما جهلنا وارزقنا تلاوته آناء الليل وآناء النهار واجعله لنا حجة يا رب العالمين ربنا لا تؤاخذنا إن نسينا أو أخطأنا ربنا ولا تحمل علينا إصرا كما حملته على الذين من قبلنا ربنا ولا تحملنا ما لا طاقة لنا به واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم صلى الله تعالى على خير خلقه محمد وعليه وسلم.